Yo, what's good, everybody? So I'm just making sure everything is cool before I get started here. Sup, Kashif? So can I keep the stream up later? I'll try my best. If YouTube doesn't tell me to take it down, that's the problem. I'm kind of under the, you know, I'm kind of under the mercy of YouTube, you know, so. Thank y'all for coming and hanging. We just chilling today, man. It's a chill stream. This is a very chill stream. Also, I got my DS. Welcome, y'all. What's up, Matt? Crescendo. Yo, what's up, Alex? Cats. Cats are out here. All right, I think I did all my announcements. So let me go ahead and close this. Yeah, I think I did all my announcements. Nice. My announcements are done. All right, let me get my chat figured out here first now. Nice. All right. Ready to get learned? That's what I'm ready to do. Be real with you. It's been a while, though, y'all. I'm happy to be here. So the latency might be a little, like, just pardon me. Like, I was going to pick ultra-low latency, but I think I just put low latency instead because I wanted to make sure that the quality was still up. So hopefully y'all don't mind that. Meaning that, like, there might be some lag between what I'm saying, like, between what you say and my response to what you're saying, so. But yeah, so today I'm going to be doing, last time where we left off, well, let me put this, my keys in my wallet out of my pocket. This is kind of, all right, cool. So last time we left off, we kind of talked about learning tunes, right? And I said I was going to do the second half of learning the song, but I think, you know, it's been a long time since then, so probably won't do that much of it today, but instead I'm going to talk some more about kind of what I, just the thing I've been trying to talk about for a while is kind of just how I think about soloing, where I'm going with it, like maybe some of my influences and how I came to understand melody in the way that I understand it now. So that's kind of basically what I wanted to do today. Talk to y'all about that. So right now we're just going to chill. I'm actually going to pull up some of my Aebersolds that I like to play with again, because that's always a good time. Except jazz and jazz-related activities. That's exactly what we're doing today, y'all. So yeah, at any time, if y'all got any questions, just let me know. It keeps the chat flowing. So, what should I start playing first? I was playing all the things earlier, right? Yeah, I like that. Play some down tempo joints. We're also gonna talk about Frankie Trumbauer. I like that Sharp 11 has been talking about him. Hopefully more people will start to understand exactly why he's important. All right, let's play a little bit. I'm gonna warm up. Let me know if the sync is cool and the volume, all that kind of stuff. Yeah, man, Trumbology. We used to play that in New York, man. Thank you.
I can't hit that.
There's no way I can hit that. Yo, good afternoon. Welcome. Let's start off by chilling. Let's play a little bit, man. Let me turn on my display capture.
One, two, three, four.
I'm sure y'all know this tune. Yo, what's up, Sangus?
Thank you.
guys. All-State Jazz memories. That's funny. Yeah. Yo, what's up, Loic? Oh, I got your message. Yeah. Let me get back to you, bro. I will be in France. Yeah, I guess I should announce I'm gonna be in Europe. I will be in Europe soon. So that is a thing. Let me drag this over here. Scopo po we ho we bo de bo ho ski de de de. Yeah, I gotta get back to you on that because I don't know how I'm gonna have time for that, but yeah, I'll let you know. What else I want to play? Yeah, these are Aebersolds, man. Great Aebersolds, bro. Oh yeah, some Lee Morgan joints, like what's that one, man? I love playing Speedball. That's a great one. I used to play Speedball a lot, man. Let's play Speedball. It's a great tune.
1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4.
I wish it was faster, but...
We'll be right back.
great track. Yo, what's up, Dom? What up, bro? Good to see you, man. Sanguis, what? Thank you. I was gonna reveal it on Twitch, but hey, maybe you'll see it on Friday again. I'll watch it. We'd love to see you in Munich. Yeah, I would love to go back to Munich. The only time I've been to Munich was for a layover in 2012. Yeah, like 10 years ago, I had a layover in Munich when I was going to Amsterdam. Kaelin. Patrick, quick question. Might not be able to go to music school. How can I still pursue my dreams of being a fluent saxophonist? I don't know where you live in the world, but you don't need music school to be a jazz musician. Especially not nowadays. Like, there's so much resources out there for people to learn how to play the music. And you can always talk to people, you know? So many of us are putting up, like, you can get, like, free Jazz Academy now, like, on YouTube. It's like, it's kind of wild. Like, you don't really need Jazz Conservatory. Like, jazz school at this point is more for, like, getting connections with people. Like, that's what I would say. Like, you go to school so you can meet people. But if you don't, you know, so... Cameron Fagers, you gotta be kidding me. No kidding, dude. No kidding. My man, wow. Okay, Cat's coming through from high school. Oh my goodness. Wait, an influential saxophonist? Oh, you definitely don't need music school for that. I don't know who told you that. I mean, how many saxophonists in history have gone to music school? I mean, obviously it sounds like a false equivocacy, right? Like, oh, but they didn't have jazz school back then. So, okay, but it's like, okay, yeah, that's the point. Oh, but they had jazz in the street. Okay, well, then go find it. Go find jazz. Wherever you can find it, you know, there's no excuse. There's no excuse. So, you know, or if there's no jazz in your area, then pack up, save some money, and move to a place where there's jazz. You know, that's just how it is. You know, like, you got to grab it if you want it. School's not the only place to learn, so. But, yeah, how you doing, Cameron? My goodness, y'all. Oh, my goodness. I've known this cat, Cameron Fager, since I was 14, 15. 15? Yeah, because you were a year younger than me. So, it's funny how, like, back in high school that mattered. Oh, man, you're younger than me. Nowadays, it doesn't, like, when you get older, it don't matter. Like, I can't believe you're freaking, like, 28 now. And I'm 29. Like, we getting old, bro. Isn't that crazy how time flies? I saw your dad, man, at the, I saw your dad at the Dillard concert. It's great to see you, man. So, I'm glad you're doing well, man. I know you're on top of the world right now, making all that money. Getting your life, man. We gotta catch up for sure, bro. Man, love you too, bro. You're the man. You're awesome. Great to see you. Great to see you, man. Yo, Arson, back. What's up, Arson? Good to see you, man. Neil, I'm curious about your thoughts on building a jazz scene where you are. Yeah, that takes a lot of time. It takes a lot of time and you gotta do a lot of work for that. Like, you gotta, like, really set, you gotta have, first of all, you gotta have a place that everyone comes to. It doesn't even have to be a club. It can be your house, you know, and people just roll through your house and jam, like, a small group of, like, 5 to 10 people that come through, and then, like, you know what I'm saying? It can start like that, and then y'all go mob someplace and restaurant, get a restaurant gig and make it a jam session. There's so much stuff you can do to start it off. You know what I mean? You gotta, you know, start small and then build it from there. Perfect time to put the clothes in the washer. Nice. That means you got to leave chat in 30, 40 minutes. What ear training do you think is best for beginners? I am the wrong person to unfortunately ask about that because, yeah. You can do that even in big cities. Well, that's different. I'm not going to go into that, but yeah. What was I going to say? I was going to say something just now. What the heck was I going to say? I don't know. I'm just going to play, I guess. But, oh, yeah. This is not J music, but LaCroix. I was going to talk about falafel. Yeah, okay. But I thought you had already watched. Yeah, no, I didn't. I never have. Like, ever. So, I love it, man. I love it. But, you know, I know it's old, so, like, you know. Like, you know, I'm into that, so. Play food choruses are standard. Yeah, I'm gonna get to that eventually. I'm just kind of warming up right now, but I will get to that eventually. I will get to that eventually. Do not worry. I'm trying to figure out some cool stuff to play now. Play some Inner Urge. Shade of Jay, Inner Urge. Oh man, what's Serenity? Play some Serenity. Yeah, last time we played Punjab, right? Let's play Serenity, man. It's a great tune.
1, 2, 1, 2, 3.
Oh wait, I gotta mute my mic and get back to it.
1, 2, 1, 2, 3.
Thank you.
I used to just sit around all day and just play this stuff in my room. Like, sometimes I'll repeat a lot of songs too, like over and over again. Like Pensativa, that's a great song. I don't have a play along for it though. You read part one on Kindle's internet browser. That's amazing. Hey, Pat, have anybody that became a great jazz musician that started later in life, like in their 30s, but had a solid classical background? That's very specific. That's like very, very, very specific. So I'm going to have to say no, unless I just didn't know. Like, I know plenty of people who started later in life. I don't know, like, how to quantify if they became a great jazz musician, because I just don't know. I know people that started late, period. Maybe not like classical musicians, but, you know, like Tim Byrne, for example, didn't start playing saxophone until he was 20, I think. So that means music, period. He didn't start anything. It's not like he started clarinet at 10 and then started saxophone at 20. No, he didn't start playing at all until he was 20. So that's like hope for people, you know, most people just like, oh man, all these prodigies, they started at like 6 and stuff. Well, this cat started at 20. He's one of my favorite, he was one of my favorite saxophone players ever. Like, I love Tim Byrne. Great sound, great. He's a great guy too. Very chill. Plays more in the contemporary improvisational scene and circuit. But yeah, that's like kind of, you let it hear me approach Billy's Bounce? That's the blues. I mean, I played a blues earlier. If you want to just play an F blues. I don't really feel like playing an F blues right now, but there's some other tunes that I like playing. Like Granted, like a C minor blues is nice. NRH, go back. There's some Bobby Watson tunes like, oh my gosh, Carita? Let me see if I remember this. Because I used to play this joint for so much. This song had a really profound effect on me. I love this song.
1, 2, 1, 2, 3.
I love Bobby Watson, man. Technically, is not. It's like I started off thinking about my little suede shoes, but then I was thinking of actually Venus de Milo. Like, you know. You know what I'm saying? Birth of the cool. You know what I mean? Yeah, you dig. I was thinking, I was like, let me go there instead because it makes more sense for the changes. No, I kind of want to play, all right, I think this is it. So I want to play Lazy Bird, but I don't have a play along for it, I don't think. So I think this song ETA is a contrafact of Lazy Bird. Let me check again.
1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4.
It sounds like Lazy Bird, basically. Yeah. Let's play this.
1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4.
To end it like that. I haven't played this recording in like 13 years. It's probably like I haven't heard that. It's funny, y'all thinking like, everybody keeps saying four because that's what understandable. I'm not thinking about four. I'm thinking Saturday night is the loneliest night in the week. That's what I'm thinking of. Saturday night is the loneliest night in the week. That's what I'm thinking, because four is, you know, that's four, right? But I'm thinking Saturday night is the loneliest night of the week. You know, that's what I'm thinking of. Yo, are you? No way, dude. Oh, okay. Oh my gosh, dude. It's all right. It's been a long time. Oh my, everybody. One of my biggest alto heroes of all time is in the chat right now, Andrew D'Angelo. If you haven't heard his own work, of course, I mean, I think I first heard his saxophone playing with Matt Wilson, but man, since I was in high school, Andrew D'Angelo has been one of my biggest, like, heroes. And, like, him, Steve Lehman, they were, like, two of my heroes on the horn. Like, you know, so it, Reed Anderson, all those cats as well, like, you know, that he played with. Thank you. It's great to see you again. I think I met you once, like, years ago when I was with Matt Muntz and all those guys. Cause I don't know. Y'all check out Andrew, everybody. He's awesome. He's one of my favorites. Wow, this is so crazy. Thank you so much for coming to my stream, man. I appreciate you. Like, I really do. This is like musical alto royalty over here, y'all. Like, please go check out Andrew D'Angelo and everything. Yeah, I think it was Matt. I think it was with Matt. Oh my goodness, this is crazy. This is beautiful. Thank you so much, man. I really, it's crazy being in this, like, kind of position now, because, like, you know, when cats, like, you come in, I'm like, I'm reminded, yes, I'm still, like, the young cat, and I'm glad to feel that way again, you know? Oh, my goodness, wow. Yeah, just, like, just how bold your sound is, and how, like, how you go for everything you play has been an extremely, extremely big influence on how I do stuff, like, the way you approach it, so it's just beautiful. Especially, like, when some of the tunes that Matt has written, like, you're going to correct all my mistakes. Do it. You heard me, right? You heard me, right? That's what I'm saying. I love when cats come, like, you come here. Everybody's like, man, Patrick Bartley, he's this. And I was like, nah, man, you don't know. But cats like him, no. Oh, my goodness. You're the man. Thank you so much. I appreciate you saying that and coming in. It means a lot coming from you. It really does. Go check him out everywhere, man. Everybody, go check out Andrew D'Angelo. Seriously, you're doing yourself a grave disservice if you don't know who Andrew D'Angelo is. It's embarrassing if you don't. But yeah, all right, you want me to check Discord real quick? Okay. Oh, yeah. Arson, yeah, I got it. Thank you, bro. Yeah, I got it. He's alto sax, man. Go check. This cat is just... Lord, I kind of want to play you. I kind of want to play you something. But I don't want to get copyright. If you're in the Discord, I'll post some of Andrew D'Angelo's music for you. Oh man, it's crazy. I'm like embarrassed to play now, bro. I can't believe what a time we're in, dude. Like, I'm up here on YouTube and Andrew D'Angelo's coming to check me out. What a time. This is crazy. All right. Cool. Let me I'm gonna play a little bit more, and again, I did want to go into talking about I want to talk about Frankie and all them other cats too, so. But let's play some other stuff that I've been thinking about. It's funny, man. So much when I really go in, like, especially playing fast, and I feel like I'm like, I feel like I gotta go for it. Like I feel like a lot of my Andrew D'Angeloisms come out, like, sometimes. Like between, like, oh my, like, all the stuff I studied with, like, Andrew. Like the stuff I've listened to Andrew and like Kenny Garrett, like, just so much. Like, I feel like some of that stuff is always, like, going to be locked into my playing. And that's why I keep going back to the history. So I don't be caught, like, copying these cats. I'm like, let me get some more, like, standard kind of stuff in my playing. I spent so much time doing that. Let me find out what I got. Yeah, everybody, seriously, he's been, like, one of my alto heroes for a long time. So go check him out. Bubble doobie doo-boo. What I got on here? Let's say y'all wanted to hear Bird or something. What tempo is this, Donnelly?
1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Let me hear how I swing. Yeah, I can play this. I play this dumbly. Bird is the one. Remember that. Eternal. All right, let's play some Donnelly. With the right notes, by the way. All right, so dig on this. Everybody plays Donnelly wrong. Everybody plays Donnelly wrong. First of all, this. Everybody plays this, right? But it's first, the first correction. It's supposed to do that. Second correction, everybody plays this. is actually, it's amazing. So just, it's something that like I'm picking up on recently. So it's incredible. Anyway. Anyway. So that bo-dibble hit a little bo-dip, but do that bo-dibble hit a bo-dibble so bo-dibble hit a 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 I think about that tune a lot. It must be recently because like June has been practicing, I guess, a lot, so I guess it's been in my head. But them fats cuts, like people all right, so I love original recordings, right? But man, them Fats Navarro cuts of some of them tunes, like my goodness, like Fats Navarro playing Our Delight, stupid. Him playing like you said, Donna Lee, him playing Dizzy Atmosphere with Burr, oh my goodness, bro. There's so many incredible cuts with Fats, like stupid. Thank you, Nestor. I still want to play a few more, man. I got the bug. Oh yeah, I was thinking about like Ornithology and Ha Ha the Moon and joint. Let me see what this sounds like.
1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Should I play that? I don't know. Let me play something else. Oh, the Tad Dameron joint. Yeah, speaking of Tad Dameron, Our Delight. Did they play this in the right key? Hold on.
1, 2, 1, 2, 3.
Yes, sir. Oh yeah, man. Get. Oh yes sir. Okay, so we got this one, Hot House. Oh yeah, Good Bait is on here too. The Scene Is Clear. That's a deep cut too. If you can see me now on a misty night. What? If y'all don't know on a misty night, y'all got to learn that tune. But yeah, let's play some Our Delight, bro. Yeah, let's play some Our Delight. Our Delight. Yes sir. Gabriel, listen to Louis Armstrong, Ella Fitzgerald, and Roy Hargrove. And Clark Terry. Spip! Hey, you know Roy coming up, he hears a spip. When you hear a spip, that's how you know what's going on. You hear, hold on, hold on, hammer, hold, lippy, hoover, hold, you got Clark Terry. You know, buddy, I'm do the Ella. Let's get the Ella. They got, sapa do zit. That's how you get the Louis Armstrong. You gotta it's just Osmosis Jones. Appreciate y'all. Yo, hey, Arson. Don't forget about Clark Terry. I mean, what I just say, Clark Terry. Don't forget about Clifford Brown, bro. Don't forget about Clifford Brown. Yo, what's up, Steve Grant? Atlas, Splatless, Osmosis Jones, you dig? Hey, you dig Osmosis Jones? All right, let's play some Our Delight, man. Tad Dameron, come on, let's swing.
1, 2, 1, 2, 3.
I gotta turn this down a little bit. Spit bubble hop, I forgot to send off, bro. Yeah, exactly, Andrew. Honestly, Andrew, that's the reason why like I vibed with you so much, because I think I like got hip to you, around the same time that I finally understood Dolphy. Like, when like, he actually, like, became a really big part of my playing as well. Like, so, yeah, that's one of the things. So, like, I made that connection kind of instantly. you know what I'm saying? Like, for real. Oh, man, Matt, yeah, that's, I love that tune. That's a killing tune. Man, wait, do they have a Taz the Light? Yeah, that's another one.
A 1, 2, 3, 4.
Oh, that's too slow. I like the Miles Temple. Yo, is there a butt? Wait, for real? Is there a butt power? Play along for Aebersold? Well, do you teach differently when for students that play? Do you teach even students that play other instruments? I mean, if they're a saxophone player, then I'm gonna teach them a lot of saxophone stuff because they play saxophone. But if they don't play saxophone, I'm still gonna teach them the same jazz stuff that I'm gonna teach the saxophone players, just without saxophone approach. But it'll basically be the same stuff because I think that, I mean, music is universal. You know what I mean? Like, no matter what you play, you're gonna play music. No matter what you play, it's going to be music. So as long as you learn how to play music, you can pick up any instrument. So, but if it's saxophone, if I get saxophone students, I'm going to. Oh, my goodness. You talk about some Chris Speed, too. See, I'm so happy that I got introduced to, like, the cats of our time. You know what I mean? Like, I'm really grateful for Matt and Xavier. They really helped hit me to, like, cats that I otherwise wouldn't have found out about when I was in South Florida because, you know, it's mostly just, like, older stuff, right? But yeah, Chris Speed, stupid good. Chris Speed and Chris Cheek, both of the Chris's. Chris Speed. I'm so happy Andrew is here, y'all, because y'all don't listen. This is the real stuff. This is like the real connection. Like, oh, it's his latest solo. All right, I'm gonna hit that up, man. Can I get it on Bandcamp? That's where I wanna support, like, new cats. You know, on Bandcamp specifically. I bought a record on Bandcamp. You know what I'm saying? Unless they have another direct way to buy it from them. So, but otherwise, if it's not, I'll just buy it either way. But Bandcamp, killing. Great. Let's play something completely different. Oh, yeah, there's Around Midnight, like, play along. Not like the album is called. I love Conception, but I don't think it's on here. Ooh, I know that you know. Oh, yeah, I think this was in C, though. This was in C. Nancy with the Laughing Face, that's another classic. This is a lot of good songs, a lot of good tracks in here, man. I'm surprised. I forgot how good this stuff is. Like, they got a lot of good songs up here. Embraceable You. See, if I play Embraceable You, I got to play it with the verse. I got to play it with the verse. Nobody does it with the verse. There, but yeah, that's true. I said, there's no dedicated one. Okay. What is a Cottontail? I remember playing the Cottontail, but I don't think I want to play it. I'll play like one more, and then I'll go into like some of the Frankie Trumbauer stuff I want to talk about. Tonight. Let me check out some other ones. You do something crazy with In a Sentimental Mood. Conservative interpretations. I don't really know how to, like, I play what I hear. So if I hear something like that, then I'll play it. But otherwise, I won't. Andrew. Yeah, Frankie Trumbauer is a really big part of me. So, yes, I'm absolutely going to be talking about Frankie Trumbauer. So, and now it's, like, hip to do so now, which is great. So, play Conception. I mean, like, I don't have a Conception play along unless there's one from the Aebersold. Because I don't want to play. I refuse to play with IRLB. So, you can hear me play Little Willy Leaps, Jerron, on YouTube with Emmett. Oh, yeah, the Cannonball play-along. I forgot about the Cannonball play-along. I played Janine at one point. Del Sasser's a great tune. Oh, yeah, the Cole Porter play-along with the standards. Yeah, with his standards on here. I Get a Kick Out of You. I Concentrate on You. My goodness. Play that one. Ooh, what about In the Still of the Night? What key is this in?
1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Like this one that much. I don't think I'm gonna play a different one. Plus, I like it in the bird key. We plays with the choir. Y'all heard that recording? I'm gonna play that for you real quick. Like, you ever heard that recording, man? It's stupid. Let me pull it up. Portrait of Genius. Which one is it? Check out this recording, man. All right, I'm gonna get copyright for this now, but. As I gaze through my window, oh,
at the moon in its light, my thoughts all stray to you.
This is one of my favorite songs, man, and recordings. Ooh, to you, oh my gosh.
Do you love me? As I love you,
oh my gosh, dude.
Are you my life to be, my dream come true?
Woo!
Okay,
Arson. Oh my gosh. Let's do this solo, man. Listen to this. Come on, bro.
In the still of the night,
woo!
As I gaze through my window,
the moon
in
its come on, bro. Woo! Come on, man. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Uh-huh. Whoa. Yes, sir. Yes, yes, Andrew. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And you know, Bird was just trying to play. That's the thing I love about Bird, man. He was just playing. This is around that time, you know what I'm saying? Like, going more commercial.
Thank you.
Come on, bro. Come on. It's bad, bro. That's so bad. Like, oh my goodness. Yeah, he was definitely forced to make this recording, but it's just like, think about it. Think about it. Think about how even under certain conditions, it doesn't sound, if there's nothing, like, he can't help but play him. Like, I just think it's deep, man. Like, some cats, like, when they get called for a certain gig that they don't like, they kind of play whatever. You know what I mean? Like, we know those stories. Like, you get called for a gig, you kind of just play. But, like, it's almost like it was like, automatic. It was like automatic for Bird to just play him. He couldn't help it. That's what I like about it. Like, I just... And so many said, like, listen, the biggest example of you can tell him being forced to do this record is my favorite recording from this session, the old folks, where, like, it's like the old folks, we've all been there, bro. Like, trust me, I know we've all been there, but, you know, it's like, isn't it funny, like, the old folks were here, the oboes, like, yeah, the flutes, the Bird come in with this country grease. It's just so funny. Check this out. Yo, that joint is so funny. It's like a shreds. Man, Andrew, that would be sick, wouldn't it? I feel like the only way to do that would be, like, on Discord or, like, Skype or something. But people don't use Skype anymore. I guess we do, you know, but. Yeah, this is, like, this ain't TV, so I can't do a call-in. Like, it's not about the B-natural, Ben. It's about the blues. The fact that he played the blues. It's not about the B-natural. We'll play the blues. Yeah, like, yeah, it's a B-natural, of course. That's the theory behind it. But the fact that he had the audacity to play the blues, because that's all he know. He go, I just think it's hilarious, bro. Like. That's funny. But yeah, I just want to show you that. I don't want to derail my night, but I just want to show you that because it's funny. Let me play one more play along and then we'll get into talking about some Frankie. You just can't be, yeah, Arson. That's just so funny. Yeah, yeah. Okay, you've done that great. Let's actually, man, you know what? Can we be in contact, man? Like, I would love to actually, like, just schedule a straight up day where it happens. Where we actually, like, I can make it about us in our conversation, like kind of a more of an interview style thing. Like, obviously we'll chat, like, you know, no, I don't want to, like, put you, like, on the spot or whatever, but it would be an honor for me to have you on, like, the channel with, for something like that. So I would actually love to do that. That's deep. Isn't that funny, Arson? It's just so funny, bro. Well, some rhythm changes. Let's play some rhythm changes. I actually like this recording. They rush in the beginning, but it's cool. Or some Cherokee. Wait, what's this Cherokee recording like? Oh, wait. No, wait. What's this Cherokee recording sound like?
1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Also, why is it Persona? What is it? Why is it Persona? Listen, Cherokee. You going live on the top. Can my mods post? Yeah, if somebody wants to post Discord, the Jamie's at Discord, go ahead and post it. This is our first time having a real, like, modern jazz master, like, in the Discord. That's really crazy. Now you get to see all the crazy crap that people talk about, including myself. Oh my god. Yeah, man. Okay. Should it be this
one?
I don't know if I like the swing feel on this one. One, two, one, two, three, four. Great, thank you. I think that's Rufus Reed playing on that. I think that's Rufus Reed on this recording, actually. The Bird one has Ron. I think the Bird one has Ron playing on it. I think the Bird one has Ron Carter. I think. It's like Ron Carter and Billy Hart or something. Arson, you have no idea how much I played with the Aebersolds when I was in high school because I had nobody else to play with. Like, I did, but not, like, on the level I wanted to play. So this is the closest that I could get to it. And they still cool. You know what I mean? But anyway, enough of that. Let's talk about Frankie Trumbauer. So Frankie Trumbauer, where's Frankie from? I think that's the one thing I never knew. Where's Frankie Trumbauer from? Squeeball, St. Louis. He from St. Louis. Frankie Trumbauer's from St. Louis. He from the barbecue state. Sorry, barbecue city. I don't know if Missouri necessarily is barbecue state, but I know that St. Louis is barbecue city. Did I see, hold on. Did I see Blade in here? Did I see Blade up in here? Yeah, Rufus is amazing. Maestro Rufus Reed, man. You heard St. Louis and barbecue. Yeah, you're greedy. You have been summoned. Yeah, it was Kenny Barron. Yeah, isn't that deep? Yeah, oh, hi, Shuba. Raged. I just recently found you and love you playing. But thank you. I went to one of my friends' side lately and one of the outside. Dang, it's already gotten to that point. Man, the fact that you know, Andrew D'Angelo is in here and seeing somebody transcribe my soul, I'm like, it's like, I don't know, man. Like, y'all, y'all got to go check out some other kids. You sure we're just gonna get? Yeah, I believe it. Look at that cat. Look. Him and Ron Carter have like. I feel like they need a competition for like the hand sizes. That's really awesome though. Thank you, Raze. I appreciate it. I'm having fun here. All right, let's a website with all upcoming gigs. Nah, man, I gotta work on my website. I just got social media stuff, but you know. All right, but you know, Arson, it's a true stare. I feel like the instrument picks you. You don't pick the instrument. You dig? Like, I think so, at least. All right. Yeah, let's talk about Frankie, man. So, for some reason, Arson did say it. I don't know how true that is about stuff I'm saying, influence other people, whatever. But yeah, there's so much Frankie that I'm into, and I spent a lot of time. I spent a lot of time with him and his music, and I actually had a band. In New York, I probably let me play a recording of it. Display capture. So if you type in Patrick Bartley and his orchestra, or just Patrick Bartley Orchestra, I guess you'll find some older recordings of me playing with my trad band, call it trad band, whatever. Any tip for a kid going to music college this fall? Have fun. Go to the college. Make sure you pack what you need. I don't know what else to tell you. You know, yo, what's up, Wes? Good to see you, bro. Yeah, what Andrew said. That's the best thing for sure. Yeah, play, like, definitely practice. Like, practice. Cause that's what Steve Wilson was my first teacher. That's the first thing he told me halfway through college. He was like, yo, man, like, use this time to play. Like, really play. Like, Because, you know, you're going to have some time to practice, but not as much as you did anymore. Like, really do it. But if you're living life like really living and having to deal with, you know, all the stuff that you got to do as an adult, yeah, you're going to like, oh, thank you, Zach. Not really Zachary, but Shuba. Yeah, practicing. That is the best freaking thing you can say. Bro, seriously, if you want to think about anything, practice practicing. Oh, my goodness. Please do not forget. That is so deep and it's so true. Practice practicing. Remember to practice for practice's sake. Remember, don't practice for a goal. Just practice. Just practice. Like, you got to practice, because if you don't enjoy that process, you're not going to get, like, you're not going to get better at anything. You know what I'm saying? You got to just practice. Just practice. Have fun and enjoy the process, man. That's what it is. It's going to be a grueling process. You're going to do a lot of stuff you don't want to do. And then eventually you're going to realize that some of the stuff you practice, you can't even play. You've been practicing the whole time. You can't play it. Why? Because it's not the time to play it. Sometimes you got to just play on the spot. Another thing that I learned from listening to Andrew D'Angelo, you know what I'm saying? Like, I could tell how the stuff that Andrew, like, if you go check out some Andrew D'Angelo stuff, the stuff that he's playing is not worked out. You dig? I'm not going to put words in his mouth because he's here in the chat, but, you know, learning how to be dynamic and playing what you hear and feel. You got to do so much work on your instrument to be able to do that. And outside of just playing like rudiments, like you got to spend a lot of uncomfortable time with the instrument and just going, you got to be comfortable with the ugly, man. Make the ugly beautiful, you know? That's how I've always played. That's how I've always played, man. Yeah, of course, Andrew. That's like, again, like, in terms of like, yeah, cats from today that like I've learned from, like, how to put this stuff into I guess when I was listening to it, 2010. How do I get to the 2010 style? But now, you know, we in 2022 now, so. Yeah, be able to sing, yeah, for sure. You know. But anyway, so is this the one where I sing? I don't know if I want to listen to that one, but that was a good recording, though. Is this Baby, Won't You Please Come Home? Let me check this out.
Check out
it's
this
an ad.
Verbal.
I forgot because, you know what? Forget this. Let me go on my YouTube premium. Hold on. I don't want to watch no ads on here. One second, y'all. You are not trolling my stream at all, Andrew. Please. Thank you for being here. You are always more than welcome to be here. Oh, no, this is Ostrich Walk. Ostrich Walk. Ostrich Walk is cool. But yeah, you see, oh, wait. Nah, there we go. Yeah, that's right there. That's Jay Ratman on bass sax. I'm playing clarinet. That's Jay Ratman on bass sax. Mike Davis on trumpet. Cause first I want to play you this first, cause I want to play, like, show you my interpretation of the stuff, how we were able to get through it, and then show you why, and then tell you why I got so much out of this music, right? But actually, I kind of want to let's listen to I Like That. This is like faster than I wanted to play it, but it's still cool. Now we got Dan Levinson, the master Dan Levinson on C-Melody. C-Melody sax, Dan Levinson. The song's called I Like That. Yeah, this was too fast. I didn't want this recorded, but they recorded it anyway, so. No way! Really, Andrew? That's awesome. That's awesome. Where did you play with them?
I
We got Bix Beiderbecke himself on a cornet. That bass drum is from 1931, I think. Might be older. Yeah, yeah, Dom, it's Ben. Nick Russo on banjo and guitar. There's Jay Ratman on bass sax. Dom, that's funny. No, that's not Ricky. That's not Ricky. I'm the only one in that room with a new horn, bro. I got a Yamaha. Dalton? Dalton's here? My dude. But man, Dalton, yo, the piano player that was on in this band is in the chat. What's up, man? All my friends are here. Man, I miss y'all, bro. I'm going to be in New York sometime in August. I'm going to let y'all know. Dalton, what's up, bro? I'm talking about Frankie today, man. Talking about Frankie. So I just wanted to play like a little bit of like kind of how we did it, you know? I wonder if there's the only two videos. I'm pretty sure these are the only two videos right here. Like, but yeah, I think this ostrich walk was pretty good too. I want to show the recording of us playing I want a recording of us playing Humpty Dumpty. That one's crazy. Hey, at least I got an old clarinet. Old. Got a 1970 R13, so. It's not the Humpty Dumpty you're thinking of. It's not that Humpty Dumpty. I'll show you it. No, Dom, it's not that one. There was no washboard in this band, Paul. No, it's 1927, not the chicken reel. That's the question I've been waiting for, Andrew. Thoughts on the ODJB? Do I think they stole the music? No. Do I think they didn't give credit? Yes. Do I think Nick LaRocca was an asshole? Yes. But steal is like, that's a hard word. That's a hard word to use because like who owns the music? You know, like, nah, I don't think they did anything wrong by playing it. Anybody can play whatever they want. But I do think they did. I do think that they were in the wrong mindset. So, no, I don't believe they stole anything. You know, I don't believe that. I don't think it's possible. I don't think it's possible to do that. It's you can make a really hard case for it, right? If we didn't have any education about, like, where the music came from, like, the history of it, if we had no education about, you know what I mean? If we had no education about, like, if we had no education about, like, Louis Armstrong, Freddie Keppert, Duke, the early Duke, you know, Fletcher Henderson, Don Redman, you know, even Gene Goldkett, you know what I'm saying? Like the cats from back. If we had no information about these cats, like, then yeah, you can make the argument because it's like they made the first recording that we know of as jazz with the ODJB one step, right? The original Dixieland one step, and then the Livery Stable Blues. Livery. Sorry, I never learned how to pronounce that, Dalton. But, you know, it's hard to make the case that, like, they stole it. But, you know, Can't even post the McKinney's cotton pickers. You can say it. You can go ahead and say it. Where do I get my hats? Swap shop. Anyway. You know what I'm talking about. But that's how I feel about it, honestly, Andrew. Do I think people are afraid to have a big vibrato when playing this music? I hear it all the time from records. Not so much people. No, I don't think people are afraid. I think people just don't know how to do it. I don't think it's a fear. I think they're afraid of sounding bad because they don't know how to do it. So you know how to do it. You don't want to not do it. He wanted to do the exact myth mole. I'll tell you the story behind that. Yes, of course, I play plenty of video games. Yeah, I do play school, yeah, for sure. Now we got Ricky Alexander. Now we got Ricky. Dalton, did you blow on this one? How did Dalton blow on this one? You said beats you? Oh, okay. You thought I had the pronunciation. Huh, interesting question. No, my setup is the same, Andrew. I just changed the way I play. Papa Hubba. I just play a very versatile setup. Like, I play a more open setup so I can narrow it down if I need to or open it up if I need to. Yo, David, good to see you, man. Oh, man, Staccato Swing is a beautiful song. Yeah, Mara Bilson hit me to it. Why am I talking about this today? So the reason why I'm talking about this today is because if you check out Lester Young, right? And this is why I'm glad people have been talking about it now. I'm gonna do a point-for-point comparison real quick. So let me duplicate tab. Okay, duplicate tab. Okay. So the first thing I want to do, let's take a listen to, any of y'all know that record, the Lester Young record with, I do this for my students too. I don't know if I did this last time, but. Yeah, that was Spiegeltan, Dalton. Remember that joint? That was the one and only time I sang in that band. I'm saying, baby, won't you please come home? And I'm glad there's no recording of that. Baby, won't you please come home? Your pappy's all alone. I have tried in vain. I didn't sing it like that, of course. I tried to sing it for real. But that's how Frankie sings it. Evermore to call your name. When you left, you broke my heart. Cause I thought we'd never part. Every hour of the day, you can hear me say, baby, won't you please come home? Come on, baby, won't you please come home? Home. Whatever. I'm sure like cats like that sound like an old man before they were old. Home. But anyway, let me hit. You know that's on Futuristic Rhythm. That's another good one too. Anyway, Frankie Trumbauer, Ringing and Twisting. I made a chart for this so that Ricky could play it. But so let's go ahead and if y'all know this record, facts. Oh, wait. Do we now call this Dixieland a tragedy? Yeah. I mean, not to be facetious. Of course, that's the answer that we want to give. But, yeah. It sounds like dismissive to say that. I know it sounds dismissive to say that, Andrew, but I agree with Dalton on this one. And that's kind of the point that I'm going to make right here when I play these two recordings next to each other. Yeah, it's like hard to, you know, because some people call certain things Dixieland, which, you know, we all know how, like, certain cats feel about that. You know, also, you know, jazz was, like, the word they were given to, like, the ragtime type music. And they changed that name to jazz for reasons beyond what we know. You know, it's all conjecture. But, yo, I'm going to play that friend. Yo, you mean No Retard? Oh, yeah, we gonna talk about that one too. You talk about some later. Somebody said, speaking of later Frankie Trumbauer, yeah, we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about that 100%. We're going to definitely talk about that. But for now, let me play. I'm going to make a point. So y'all know about Lester Young. If y'all know about this Lester Young album with the Oscar Peterson Trio, one of my favorite albums ever. I love it. Yeah, okay. So, Andrew, all right. So I'm not going to talk about my man on the stream. I think there's a very specific reason why he thinks that way. And I've had conversations with him. He's a great guy. I love him, but we definitely have some differing opinions. I agree more with the way Kelso thinks about the music. Oh, no. Sorry. I'm not please don't apologize. I'm just saying that I don't want to like, in case I end up saying something that could be interpreted as bad. I'm down to talk about Dan, cuz Dan Levins is awesome. Great cat. Yeah, but just, like, we definitely have some different opinions. But, like, you know, John Eric Kelso has also played in the first version of this band that I had about 6 years ago. And, yeah, I agree kind of more with how he approaches that kind of stuff. That's one of the things I do want to go back to New York. I want to hopefully I'm there the same time that the Irregulars are playing. I think that was, like, the first Sundays or something. First Saturday. I forgot exactly what day. I'll message him and figure it out. But I'm going to make my rounds when I'm up there. But yeah. They're just different ideas. Large ensemble with tube instead of double bass is deaf. But why is that Dixieland, though? Why is that Dixieland? Because they play, you know, they didn't call the music out of New Orleans Dixieland. That was definitely not Dixieland. And that had tuba in it. And that's not exactly true either. I mean, like, it was, you know, again, there's a lot of interesting things that people say about that era, but you know, I'm not gonna get into that too much. That's when we're gonna watch. We're gonna watch some Ken Burns. It talks a lot about that, but check this out. So this record right here, almost like being this song, this track is something that I think everybody should learn anyway. It's a really beautiful, great song. But Lester Young, if you look up let's look up Lester Young, Frankie Trumbauer. I don't know if you'll be able to see it. You probably won't be able to see it. But so right up in here. I didn't know about this website until like a month ago because I've known about this quote. I've known about specifically this quote for years since I was like in college. But I didn't really know. I didn't really know about this website. But this is great. So check this out. C melody saxophone, rarely heard today, was very popular in the 1920s. The acknowledged master of that instrument was Frank Trumbauer, friend of Bix Beiderbecke. Lester Young talked about the influence that Trumbauer's playing had on his own sound in the lower-pitched tenor saxophone. And he says, "Did you ever hear Frankie Trumbauer play Singing the Blues? Heard that, and it tricked me. That's where I went. Trumbauer was always telling a little story like I like to hear. He played the C melody saxophone, so I tried to get that C melody sound out of my tenor. That's why I don't sound like other people." Obviously, people like to talk stuff, right? But you might be like, okay, he's just saying that. Well, check this out. These recordings are 30 years apart. So there's a lot of time for people to evolve, right? So you probably like, 30 years is a long time. Like, you might change your play style. Check this out. So I can drop a pin anywhere. Like, let me make sure this isn't play. I can drop a pin anywhere on this line and then drop a pin anywhere on this line, and this sound it'll sound exactly the same. It's going to mess you up when you hear it. It's going to mess you up. Oh, I know about Blue Giant. I haven't read it yet, though. Quizzical. So check this out. Beautiful recording. I love this song. Bring on the copyright strikes. When I tell you how much this track has influenced me, this whole album, bro. No shoe, but I have it. It's that swing, bro. That's it. It's groovy, man. Alright. Ooh, I mean. Well, it's not the lyrics there, but whatever. Hey. Check my man out. Okay, okay, all right. Sounds great, beautiful, right? Check this out. 1927, ringing and twisting. I got a chart for it. I will pull it up for you. Let me go find it. It's kind of a general chart, though. I didn't, you know, all the embellishments later, whatever, but... I think it's in my documents folder. Pull this up. PC backup. It's from my old computer. Bix and Tram. There you go. All right. These are all my charts that like I did for the band. I feel like some of my students don't transcribe the inflect. Thank you. I got a master in the chat talking about. See, if y'all don't believe me, check out this man. Check out the man I'm talking about. Yes, that's what I talk. That's what I do. That's what I enforce that. All of my students, like when, for all my students transcribing stuff, like I think it's impossible. Like, okay. All right. I'm going to do this comparison real quick. Then I'm going to talk about that. I'm going to talk about that. Because I have all my students. We'll spend an entire month on one transcription. I don't do the whole, like, one transcription a week and keep going. Like, nah, we're going to spend a whole month, maybe 2 months. I remember the first semester, so I taught for four or five months at University of Miami. We did two solos. That's it. We did two solos because they were not done until they can play it exactly like them. Like, we did Cannonball, Dizzy's Business, and Charlie Parker, Groovin' High live. And until they got it, they weren't playing it. And the reason why I did that is because there's things about, like, the music itself that you learn that you don't learn from the notes. Because, like, if you're trying to learn how to sound good, you gotta practice stuff that sounds good. Like, it seems like everybody's trying to run, like, oh, I'm not going, you know, I don't want to be a copy. I don't want to be such and such. Like, man, like, did you transcribe the words when listening to you? Like, how do you get an accent? How you be from North Carolina versus Georgia? And you get an accent, you know what I'm saying? Like, how you get an accent? You transcribing the details when you listen to your mom and dad growing up. And then you transcribe your friends. You start picking up stuff. That's how you do it. Right? That's how you do it. But you're not thinking about it. You're not thinking, I'm going to be myself, blah, blah, blah. So why in music do we got to feel this way? Like, this jazz is like the only type of music where we feel so like, you can go to, like, funk musicians, rock musicians, gospel musicians, whatever, and they'll be like, yeah, I love that James Brown record or I love that P-Funk record, and they want to play exactly what they're playing. Like, they love that. They want to play that. They want to sound like that. You tell a jazz musician about Bird, they're like, man, like, yeah, I got the notes. What I got to do? I don't know where that came from, but I'm not a part of that. I want to play that. I hear Bird, I'm playing Bird. I hear Cannonball, I'm playing Cannonball. I'm going to play that just because it sounds good. Classical musicians do that. Classical musicians got to learn all, but here's the difference. The difference is that, like, you know, their music is written, right? Like, it's written, and they write all the inflections. They write the accents, the slurs, the dot. They mark up. There's more pencil on the page than ink, right? So classical musicians do that. But jazz musicians don't. We just want to be lazy about it. I don't know why. You know, because, like, people see jazz as, like, people think jazz is, like, easier. So, like, I feel like jazz musicians, like, sometimes they be like, yeah, I take a break from having to be specific. You know what I'm saying? I feel like a lot of jazz musicians want to take a break from being specific. And I'm not into that. I'm personally not into that. I think we have to be very – this joint is hard. This joint is hard, bro. We got to really, like, spend the same amount of time with our craft in the same way that our classical brethren, you know, are doing it. We have to do it. We have to do it that way. But anyway, let me pull up this Ringing and Twisting. It's in concert. Part of it's like technical restriction for the level they're at. Once again, tell that to some classical students who are in beginning band learning how to play an accent. How many of y'all been in beginning band? Some 12-year-olds where your band director say blend and balance. How many of y'all remember that blend and balance, dynamics? I don't think it got anything to do with technical restriction. I don't think it got nothing to do with technical restriction. It just, it has to do with people not putting the emphasis on that, because people are just like, oh man, you get your own sound, blah, blah, blah. Nah, man. Forget all that mess. Forget that. Also, for some reason, the lines look weird. Sorry about that. Sorry, you probably can't see the chart that well. I'm going to do this for now. You can't see my face, but let's just do this for now so you can see the notes. So hopefully that works. But, man, just let me play triple forte in peace. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe Andrew, like, you know, you're just a few years my senior. So maybe you can help, you know, maybe you can give some insight. That's why I want to have you on the channel, man. I want to have you on the channel. But anyway, so let me remind you of the sound of Lester Young real quick, right? All right, cool. So now let's go listen to some Frankie Trumbauer. Ringing and Twisting, 1927. What does that sound like? Huh? What does that sound like? What does that sound like? Who does that sound like? That sound like? All right, so you put it. All right, let's go back and listen to some prayers. All right, now we're going back over here. Amazing. All right, let's drop a pin over here. Great, all right, what about over here? Let's go here now. Great, all right, let's go like over here, back here. I like doing this because I like doing this because it's just important for people to see where it comes from. That's what I like doing. Like Marcus Strickland says, seek the source. That's how I like to do it too. We have a little different ideas on how we interpret it, but we still. Thank you, Andrew. I appreciate it. Thank you. No, I'm not calling you old. I'm just saying, like, I respect your experience. You know, so we have to. You know, we have to because. Yeah. Using the studio with some 20-something musicians, I said, let's drop the needle, and they had no idea what's up. See, I was around at the end of records, so I'm happy about that. You know, I got to experience the end of records. I was a little kid, but at least I still experienced the end of them. You know, like, and now we're in the era of them coming back. I said that on stream the other day. I said, I remember being at the end of records, and, you know, before they went out of style. And then somebody was like, went out of style. They're here. We have records. I'm like, oh my God. We're in the era of people not knowing that records were out of style for like at least 10, 15 years, right? Because everybody wanted CDs. So it's just funny. But I think it's funny. I think it's funny. Like they're back now. So, but Brandon Sonny Clark, you just Yeah, it's a great record. That is a great record, yes. But, yeah, so I wanted to play this because, like, you know, just you can understand the connection, right? Frankie Trumbauer, Lester Young, like, if you go back, right, you can keep going back. If you like Kenny Garrett, right? You know, oh, even better, you got Andrew D'Angelo. You like Andrew D'Angelo, right? So you got Kenny Garrett, you can go back to, like, Coltrane and Cannonball, right? You got Andrew D'Angelo, you can go back to, like, Dolphy, Bird, all those cats. Okay, where did they get their stuff from? Okay, Bird is a common link. Okay, where did Bird come from? We all know, we talk about Bird and Lester Young, all right? And then we kind of stop. We got some kind of weird narrative. And let's not sugarcoat it, man. If something doesn't sound hip to some people, they don't want to hear it. And they won't talk about it. It's the same reason why black people don't talk about Louis Armstrong. We're going to go over that in Ken Burns Jazz Episode 9, though. So don't worry about that. Not 9 and 10. But you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying, bro? So a lot of people just don't like old music. It's just a fact. And during those times in the 1940s and 50s, the younger cats were rejecting the old stuff. They're rejecting the old stuff. And to be fair, a lot of the older cats back then were rejecting the new stuff. So that's just how it was. It wasn't even, like, called bebop. It was just a new thing. Critics called it bebop. Bird didn't call his joint bebop. The only reason why Dizzy called his joint bebop because he was embracing it and wanted to make it popular. He was trying to make some money off the joint. He wanted to actually get people into the music. So, you know, that was the word, so let's use it. It was the name of a song. Bebop was just the name of a song. So... The old people were once young people too. Yeah, but, like, you know, I'm experiencing a form of it. You know, it takes a very, like, I like learning from cats like Andrew because, like, it takes a lot to, like, grow up with something specific that you love. And then, like, you know, 20, 30 years later, you start to see that, like, the world is nothing like it was before. So you still got to learn to survive in it. You know what I mean? So cats like Louis Armstrong and them, you know, Louis Armstrong changed the world in the 1920s. Completely changed. We're only reason we're doing music the way we do now in any form is because of Louis Armstrong. But then Bird came up and messed everything up for everybody. Bird didn't reject the old stuff. Bird didn't reject it. It was the other cats around him that didn't understand. You know what I'm saying? So, like, the whole generation that lived longer than him, unfortunately, those ideas carried with them, and they carried those ideas to other people. So we're not going to have a lot of appreciation for, like, things before 1945, unless it's big band swing like Count Basie and Duke Ellington. That's the only time you'll see some appreciation for it, but you won't see any appreciation for, like, New Orleans jazz or, like, you know, Chicago, New York 20s music. You're not gonna see a lot of appreciation for that because, like, you know, that stuff is seen as corny, playing on the beat and all this kind of stuff, that, you know, no flatted fifths. You know what I mean? What's my take on Bird practicing 12 to 14 hours a day? I mean, you know, you didn't have iPhones back then. You didn't have, you know, I used to say, like, we don't have Xbox back then. Now it's phones. You didn't have Instagram, you know? You didn't have to look at your phone constantly, check your emails or whatever. So times were different, you know what I mean? And you grew up in the country too. So, but also Bird was Bird. Just because Bird did that doesn't mean that's what you have to do. I didn't practice 12, 14, 17 hours a day. I didn't practice that. I didn't do that. Did I ingest music for that long? Yes. I listened to music for that long. I didn't practice. Like, I didn't do that. But, you know, naturally, if you do something like that, you might, you know. Exactly, Mank. Mank Hobley. But anyway, yeah, like, everybody talks about Lester, but nobody talks about Frankie, and that's what we're going to talk about Frankie today. But before I do that, let me go ahead and address something that Andrew was talking about. Inflections, transcribing with inflections. I already made a video on this. You can go check out that video, but let me just do this. I like to do this for people, so I just couldn't put this up because of copyright. But when I transcribe these cats, I do everything, like, every single thing. Yeah, Andrew, yeah, 6 to 8 hours, that's, like, the most that I practice, like, a day. But, like, or, like, I would practice for 30 minutes, put my horn down, 2 hours later come back and practice for another hour, put it down, another 3 hours later, practice 4 hours, you know. Like, it was spread out, you know, you know what I mean? Whenever, like, on the weekends and stuff, but. Now I just practice whenever I get inspired on something or I feel like I got to work on something, so. You practice until you don't need to anymore. And then you just doing, you just working out. You're just doing, because at a certain point, like, you got to stop practicing. People aren't going to, like, you can't tell young people that because, you know, you can't tell young people that because then young people going to think, I don't have to practice anymore. But it's not about you don't have to practice. It's about, like, at a certain point, you already know how to play music. So start playing some music. If you like, a lot of cats just, like, they just keep practicing and they don't. Even train, bro. Like, Train wasn't just, like, practicing scales constantly. Like, all this, like, he wasn't looking for how advanced he could get. Train was looking for music. He practiced so he could play music. You dig? Like, at a certain point, you gotta stop practicing. Like, you practice too much, you're gonna sound like you practice. You gotta play. You gotta practice practicing and then practice playing. You gotta play. Because, like, the way I learn how to play is by practicing playing. The way I get my fingers together is by practicing. You dig? That's the thing. Practicing and playing are two different things. So get with that. You gotta get with that. Gotta eat your greens when you're young. Man, you gotta eat your greens every day. I don't care how long it takes. Eat your greens when you're 65. Don't stop eating your greens. But anyway, I know what you're saying. They said Bird liked Tristano because Tristano didn't try to copy him. Yeah, I mean, people gotta realize, when I say copy the inflections, we're not in that time period anymore. Every single saxophone player alive around Bird was trying to sound like him. Do you know how annoying that could be? It's not saying, like, oh, the way to get better is by not copying me. No, it's just that Bird didn't say that because he thought it was, like, educational. He said that because he was tired of people copying. Like, people didn't want, like, it was like, stop it. Stop taking all my stuff, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's annoying. Can you imagine that? How do you think I feel with all the, like, you know, all the anyway, I'm not gonna get into that. Those of y'all in the Discord know how I feel about it, but you know, it's, come on, dude. You never had something sound so nonsensical, but still have it make so much sense. I mean, it's not nonsense, but yeah, I hear you. Did I practice? Alex. Anyway, so the reason why I do that is because you got to realize, like, practicing that way with the what is my definition of playing? Yo, Andrew D'Angelo, facts. Andrew, facts, Andrew. But what is my definition of playing? Playing. Like, play. Like, turn on an Aebersold and play the way I was playing. Like, I'm not, don't practice, like, you know, don't. Like, if you're doing this, if you go into a song and you're doing this, like, let me pull out an Aebersold. I didn't want to do this, but I'm gonna do it now. What's a good example? What's a good example? Let me play something where I'm just practicing. Oh, I got it. Oh, perfect. Let's go. Let's play Giant Steps. Let's play some Giant Steps. All right. So, Jamie Aebersold, John Coltrane. Let's play some Giant Steps. Yeah. Here we go. Let me give you an example. Of practicing versus playing.
1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4.
All right, here we go. Practicing versus playing. Perfect example. Like, you gotta, like, when I hear music, I play music. When I'm trying to get through some changes, I'm getting through changes. So stop. So you—that's practice. You're trying to get through the changes, like, very deliberately. Can I hit every single change? Very deliberately. But sometimes, pull out the Aebersold and play the first thing you hear. Right? Like this. Like practice making some melodies. Practice making some making some sounds that sound good. Practice like activating your mind.
Three, four.
Take risks. You got like the way you play is by dealing with risk management. I was going to do a video about this so I could have my ideas planned out more, but you know, like, you got to deal with risk management when you play. Like, okay, when you practice, you're sounding bad because you're trying to be correct. When you play, your goal is to sound good because you're trying to be okay with being wrong. You dig? Like, like that because when you practice, you're working towards something. But when you play, it's time to let go of all of that stuff. Like, when you play, it doesn't, like, when you practice, you're thinking about, like, all of your, like, limitations and trying to break them, whatever, like, trying to get better, dealing with something. But when you play, it's you are here right now. Like, you're here right now is where you are. You can't go any further because time is not allowing you to go further. You're just pushing forward in time. So you have to deal with whatever you know right now. It's like when it's time to go. Like if you got a trip, you got a trip coming up. Your flight's in like 8 hours. You're trying to pack up. You got to go to the airport. Well, listen, I know you wanted to get this. You're thinking maybe I should pack this. Maybe so. Well, you got 3 pairs of drawers, underwear. You got this, you know, you know what I'm saying? You got like this jacket. You got, like, these pants. You got whatever. That's all you got. So go. Make the best of what you got with that. You don't have time to go to Macy's and pick up some new pants. You don't have time to go to this, you know, oh, like, I got this peanut butter now, but I wanted to get this peanut butter. So what? You better make that peanut butter. Like, enjoy it. You know, oh, I wanted to pick up this spice. Well, because, you know, you got to cook. You got, like, you know, you in your house. You got to cook something. You got an onion, pepper, some rice, some seasonings. You better make that. You better make them onions taste good. That's all. You got it. You can't practice. You gotta. You hungry and you gotta eat. What are you gonna do? That's how you gotta play. So you gotta play with what you have right now and just not care. Like you. Of course, you might not sound how you want to sound yet, but that's okay. You're pushing forward when you practice. Remember, you're pushing towards being excellent, and when you play, you're pushing towards your limitations. You gotta be willing to like you're going to something. Like you're going for something. You know what I mean? You're going for something. That's the deepest thing you can do is going for something in the moment. Cause you're trusting that I'm not gonna get shot. I'm not gonna get stabbed. I'm not gonna die, whatever. Like what am I afraid of? I can worry about that stuff when I actually have to be worried about it. But the only thing that's gonna happen is that you don't like what you played. Oh. And if you can turn that off, if you can turn that part of your brain off, then you start playing some stuff. When you start turning off that part of your brain that rejects what you sound like, oh my gosh, that's why church musicians, Like, if all the best church musicians in the world learn how to play jazz, every single jazz musician should be out of a job. Because, like straight up, if you took all them, like, Kojic musicians, Pentecostal, Baptist, whatever, like, all them, you know, Episcopal, you take all them, like, gospel musicians and taught them how to play jazz for real, we would be all out of a job. Why? Not because that three-year-old's got chops. Not because they play, like, all these crazy organ stuff. No, because they don't care. Because they came in to play. Because they're having fun. And if it's one thing that all these, like, you know, Western-influenced, like, classical-minded, like, self-depreciating musicians got to learn from gospel music is that, like, they accept music. Listen, he's not my boy, Corey. I was just going to say that, you know, that's what we say in the South, like, my boy, Corey Henry, whatever. But, like, yeah, Corey Henry, great example. Man, this cat is all on top of the world. Why? Because he gets it, bro. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's not even about, oh, it's like Oregon or whatever. No, just the fact that when you learn to accept yourself and accept the reality, you know, like, if you learn to accept music, you start playing it. Anyway, yeah. I wanted to pull up this bird. So what I was talking about, this bird recording right here. So Charlie Parker, like, when you play with the inflections, you get into the mindset of the player, right? Like, when you play the inflections, you get into the mindset of the player. And what that means is that you realize that if you play with these inflections, you realize they would not play those lines any other way. Like, if they had a different accent, they wouldn't say this, you know? Like, and yeah, Dalton, that's great. Yeah, man. But yeah, because it's a hard thing to break through, understandably. But, and everybody has so many, it's because we hear so many opinions. That's why, like, you got so many people got these, like, you know, every, you know, whatever. Everybody got these weird opinions about music, you know, that are very locked in their ways. And it's okay. Everybody's very opinionated. The problem is when people only hear those types of opinions, like, oh, man, you should, like, play more complicated because nobody wants to hear just simple stuff. Or, man, stop playing, like, complicated stuff. Only people want to, like, the music that really moves people is when they play simple. Like, people have all these weird, like, ideas about music that don't tell the full picture of it. So when you only get into this one type of thinking, you know what I mean? Like, then it kind of, like, well, it leads your brain into other places if you don't have, like, good mentorship or you don't have good, like, again, accepting all of it. Like, I only became a good player once I was able to go through the, like, I'll play you some straight down the middle Frankie Trumbauer, very clean, nice soloing, and then, like, let's go talk about John Coltrane's Ascension. You know what I'm saying? Let's go. Let's go to Gambit. Let's run all of it. I'm not saying that you should be able to do all that stuff. I'm just saying that, like, you become unlocked. You know, like an unlocked iPhone or something, where, like, you can be on any carrier. Well, you can unlock your brain if you just think about music as music, you know, like, and not in a cliche sense. It's very important to dig with that. And that takes a lot of time. It takes a lot of honesty and fear. It takes a lot of getting over fear, you know, but because being able to go bounce back from all of that stuff and dig into it is part of the reason why I can hear the articulations in birds playing and play them, or Miles. You know, one of these days I'm going to talk about Miles. I'm going to talk about Miles in the next stream because Miles had an extremely profound effect on me. But anyway, I'm going to play this and I'm going to talk about it. I'm going to play both Bird solo and then I'm going to play Miles solo. And I'm going to tell you what I learned from practicing these inflections. You got to play the melody right too. Don't forget about that. Thank you. So why I play it that way? You dig? Why I play it that way? All right, good night, horse dog. Thank you for coming out. Listen to that. This is the way Miles play. You hear that? You can't play that line. You can't play, like, if you play that like this, like, you know. You don't. If Miles played with that kind of phrasing, right? If Miles had that kind of phrasing, he wouldn't play that. Miles would not play those notes. He would not choose to play those notes. You got to understand. Miles would not play those notes if he didn't have that phrasing. The notes are connected to the phrase. That, like, they're connected to the phrase. So you got, like, you know, everything everybody plays is attached. There's a phrasing element and a note element. You got to put them together, and that's how you get music. Like, that's how you play jazz. You can't just play the notes. So you got to learn specifically, if you want to learn how to get your own phrasing, you got to learn how to copy the phrasing of other musicians so that you understand how to phrase good. It doesn't mean how to phrase like this person and then only phrase like this person. No, here's an example in history of some of the best phrasing you can ever hear. How do we learn from it to make our own phrasing? We have to learn from that. We're learning from it. We're not taking it and only playing that for the rest of our lives. We're taking it because we love it and we like it. And then we go and play music with our friends. We write our own tunes, make your own compositions, play blueses at different tempos, play rhythm changes, different tempos, different tunes in different keys, and learn to, like, have that delicate dance and battle with your instrument. And then you learn very specific phrasing things that teach you stuff. It's not just playing opera vibe in F and playing this exact lick and that's all you do. You got to take it and make it into something. So that's why, like, we learn how to do it. And now I have an example in the back of my head on how to phrase. I love it. That's how I do it. So that's why we do it like that. But anyway, let's go back to Frankie Trumbauer. So I want to play a couple of great Frankie Trumbauer's things. And if you haven't heard Singing the Blues, you know, that's one you got to check out for sure. But let's do some. Every saxophone player should transcribe Singing the Blues. But there's some other Frankie Trumbauer stuff that you got to dig on. Like, I'm gonna show it to you. All right, you told me to show it, so I'm gonna show it. So this song is supposed to be No Retard, but yeah. Yo, Babaco, good to see you. But check this recording out of Frankie Trumbauer from 1940 going off. Dalton, if you're still in here, this is the recording you told me to show him. Man, old cats, man, they were just too simple. Oh, yeah, I like playing outside the chain. They weren't really, like, innovative. What? Listen to this. What? The nerve. The audacity. Bro, how you had the audacity to play all that? Whatever the heck you was playing, how you have audacity, and then after all that, you go. I tell you, bro, Louis Armstrong messed everybody up. You messed everybody up. Louis Armstrong tore everybody a new one. And this is before Bird got on the scene, right? So, yeah, I don't really use Spotify that much. But, you said, what albums? Oh, record. It's not an album. Like, they, it was just a cut. You know, they didn't have albums back then. But, yeah, just Au Provolve. It's one of the Verve sessions with Miles. Is it Verve or Dial? I'm pretty sure it was Verve, right? That was a Verve cut. I'll post a link. Yeah, listen to that joint, man. What? Just love hearing that. Oh my God, dude, like, it's just like, you can't believe it. You can't believe it. You can't believe it, bro. You can't believe it. You can't believe it, bro. Like, you can't, bro. You like, oh my gosh. But anyway, yeah, and there's some other nice Frankie stuff. Like, the thing I love about these Frankie cuts is that you learn a lot of, you learn a lot about, like, how they play, like, how they sounded. And how they interpreted music. A lot of great songs. A lot of great songs with a lot of great, cool, like, nice, lovely little lyrics and melodies. I personally really love the recording of him playing Louise. Yeah, Dalton, I wanted to play this with the band, but I didn't have time to transcribe it. But I really wanted to do this track too. It's a beautiful. Oh, Bye-Bye, man, I gotta roll through Mona's and play Bye-Bye Blues, because that's the only place you can call that tune. Bye-Bye Blues. Da, da, da. I love that tune, man. That's another one. But check this joint out right here. Like, play this music, you gotta approach it a certain way. You gotta play it a certain way.
The trees seem to twiddle Louise. Each little rose tells me it knows I love you. I love you. Every little beat that I feel in my heart seems to repeat what I felt from the start.
Each little pine tells me that I adore you,
Louise. Just to see and hear you brings joy I never knew. But to be so near you thrills me through and through. Now everyone can see why I wanted your kiss.
It had to be bodily wonder.
I forgot that part, dang it.
Can it be true?
Someone like you. All right, check this out. You gotta The thing about this music, like, you got to play with the beat, too. So, you got to, so with the new, all right, you got to do the phrasing. What does that mean? Phrasing doesn't just mean inflections. Phrasing means the beat. You got to play the beat. You got to play the beat. They say, choom, chack, choom, chack, 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 choom, chack, 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 boom, boom. They're not saying, chack, chack, ding, chack, ding, pa, choom, chack, like, nah, you can't, chack, chack, choom, chack, chack, giant quarter notes, boy. That, chack, 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 boom, boom. I fell in love with this music because I'm like, bro, this hip hop, bro. Like, you know, I was like, this the beat. This the beat, bro. This the beat. This is the beat. The beat goes on. Beat goes on, beat goes on. It's the beat, bro. So other songs that got the beat like this, you know, like Baltimore. Baltimore, that's a great joint. Like playing the Baltimore. We played the Baltimore. That was nice. This is called Louise. It's called Louise. That's what you're saying, Louise. What other charts I got that I can show y'all? So do po dapple po ska on da on ski dee dee do si do ba oom little dapple he oom catch. Like when you learn to feel that, like, feeling the nuance means you can feel everything about the music. So you got to learn how to feel the beat, too. You got to feel the beat. Like, if you can't play that beat like that, then you're not doing all of it enough. You got to feel that beat. I told you I was going to show y'all Humpty Dumpty. I'm going to show you that in a minute. But I want to show y'all that tune. I like that. And the way they play it, too. I'm going to put up the sheet music again. Let me put up the sheet music real quick for you. I'm going to have to stop playing at like 9:30, and then after 9:30, I'll go to the, we'll do the Ken Burns thing if I got time. If I don't have time for the Ken Burns today, then we'll do it tomorrow after my lessons are finished. Oh, I love Love Affairs. That's another one too, man. I think it's also important to note that the changes are not simple. Thank you, Dalton. It's not simple change. Oh, yeah, just B flat. Oh, just triads. It's like, bro, because they weren't changes yet. People were playing actual notes. Like, straight up notes. They wrote the notes out, or they knew what the notes were that they had to play. It wasn't like, oh, yeah, man, B flat 7 is always going to be this. It's like, nah, bro, this is very specific notes. Very specific notes. Yes, the use of inversion, yes. 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 All right. Should I play Raising the Roof? I love that song, man. Either Raising the Roof, Baltimore, Crazy Cat, so double hobo da weed up. Like, Good Man's Hard to Find. I haven't heard that one in a while, too. There's so many lessons you can learn from just, like, playing this music. We can do, you know what? We got time. Let's do all of it. We got time. Let's do all of it. So let me put up some sheet music for I Like That. I put it in the alto part. Let me put the solo up here. Right there, you know what I'm saying? So let's go check this out. 1929, great track. There has to be a better version of this. This one? That's all right. Bye. I'm just trying to expose y'all to some of this music. That's all I'm really doing. I'm just trying to expose y'all to some of this music. Cause a lot of people haven't heard this before, and like how amazing and beautiful it is. Let's do another beautiful song I like called "Love Affairs." Amazing, a song that's called "Love Affairs" could be beautiful, right? But anyway, all this stuff applies to upright bass. This stuff applies to everything you do. If you want to play it in style, go ahead and do it. Go check out some Pops Foster, some Arvel Shaw. You know, like, Arvel's not that, he wasn't that old, but, you know, he played with Pops. He had that beat. You know, he had that beat. So, Benny Moten is a little different. Benny Moten didn't play like that. It's different, but. Yeah, you go check out the Humpty Dumpty in a little bit, but I wanna play this tune too. What happened to Tram after the 1930s? The music changed. I mean, it's not that the music went past him, it's that Frankie didn't play, that he didn't go with the new craze. He tried a little bit, but you know, there was the music started to have a new image. You know, because even Louis, you know what I'm saying, like Louis was just Louis, and everybody there was always constantly an audience for him, but. You know, to be quite honest with you, bro, like, even back in the day, Frankie was kind of, like, not fringe, but Frankie didn't really become the star that he should have become. You know what I mean? Like, he didn't become the star that he should have become because there were other musicians that eventually outshined him. And that's basically the only reason why we don't really talk about him that much. Like, basically, his legacy lives on through cats like Lester Young and Bert, you know, who, like, checked him out, so. But we can go into that. We can go into that eventually too, though. But just check out how this song is amazing. Man, Bix, bro, Bix.
Jealous because you always knew that my love affairs were all with you.
What? I need to edit. We go right to the swinging. Thank you. Wow. 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 Music is deep, dude. Music is deep, bro. All right, let's get funky with it. Let's raise the roof. Raising the roof? This is a J. Russell Robinson cut, right? Or am I tripping? I forgot. Who wrote this tune? Dalton, you remember? Medicine. Get some, hey, I know about some Harlem Hellfighters. That's St. Louis Blues they do too, is killing. But I got charged for this one too. Raising the Roof, we play this one. Oh, what? What? Raising the Roof. I think it's J. Russell Robinson, man. It might be somebody else. J. I think it was a J name. It's Jimmy McHugh. Yeah, I knew it was a J name. I don't know why I thought it was J. Russell Robinson. He's the one that wrote all them D minor tunes that sounded the same. Like, didn't J. Russell Robinson wrote Everybody Loves My Baby and I Found a New Baby? Didn't he write both of them? Or am I tripping? But have I gotten to James Reese Europe? I mean, I do, but that's not who I'm talking about today. Talking about Frankie Trumbauer. Let me show y'all that Humpty Dumpty real quick. It's called Raising the Roof. Raising the Roof. That's what that was called. Now we're going to talk about Humpty Dumpty. You should call it Wow, Babaco. Yeah, exactly. Like, oh, man, how does he relate this stuff to J-pop? Why does he like that stuff? Okay. My life is complicated. All right. So this is Humpty Dumpty, but not the one that you know of. Thank you. up this chart. Hold on, let me pull up this chart real quick for you so you can see it. Oh, no, I think, actually, no, this is not the C melody part. I wanted to play this solo, so I put it in the alto part. Ah, that's what you can do when you're the band leader. Ah, all right, anyway, let's pull this up real quick. Make this the... I want y'all to see this. This is an alto key. Yeah, I know he wrote Singing the Blues, but there was one composer who wrote like the same joint. It was like the same. But anyway, let's go back a little bit. Tell me this joint ain't hip. You can't look me in the face with a straight eye and be like, nah, this ain't out, this ain't hip. Yeah, definitely Eddie Lang and Joe Venuti. Yeah, it's 100% Joe Venuti. Yeah, you can't go wrong with that. That's Joe Venuti all day. All day Joe Venuti, for sure. But yeah. Yeah, man. Yeah, man, that's the Humpty Dumpty I knew before. Like, I didn't know that tune, actually. I didn't know that tune until, like, last year. I never learned Humpty Dumpty until last year. Like, the shit Korea. Because I had to play it with Brad and Thomas Pridgen. But, yeah, just incredible, incredible stuff, man. But who listened to this music? This guy. But also, that's the thing about this era. People were just happy to listen to music. They were buying records. They're buying records, man, because that was the hot new technology, the hot new thing. If you had a record player, you know what I'm saying? You had a record player, man, you want to grab some records. So records sold. You know what I mean? It's extremely important. But if you want to talk, fair point. I think somebody said, thought it was early jazz stream. Okay, so let's talk about Louis Armstrong. Let's talk about Louis Armstrong then. Louis Armstrong. I'm going to keep this. You want to talk about a beat? Check out Heebie Jeebies. If you don't know, this recording, man, you're doing yourself a grave disservice. Check out Louis Armstrong Heebie Jeebies. Require listening for all Negroes and all non-Negroes alike. Why am I saying this? Because black people got to hear this joint. That's why I'm saying it like that. A record player is like a smartphone. Yes, exactly. You better get your black behinds to this recording and listen to this joint, because this is their origins. You can play some listen to the sea over this. Deck it to get it to get check it to get it to get. You can play it. This is the origins of music. Come on, bro. This is hip. When we go up to the black side of town, you are hearing this kind of music. You gotta dig that. You ain't digging on that, bro. You ain't hitting it. You ain't digging that. You ain't hitting it. You gotta dig that. Dig that, man. Like, what? What? It's so killing, bro. Somebody told me to talk about Hotter Than That. That's another one too. But anyway, I think I reached my playing limit. My musical playing limit, unfortunately. Like, I could keep playing all day if I wanted to, but just, like, I can't play too much more in the house. So, just for noise reasons. So, oh, it's 100% getting copyrighted. You already know that. I'm seeking out the copyright at this point. How am I supposed to teach y'all this music, you know? That's why I think, like, I'm gonna start making these, like, kind of a private masterclass series. But if I do that, I want it to be more organized. You know what I mean? I want it to be more organized if I do that, because now it's just kind of hanging, right? So, I want to make it a little more organized if I do that. So, y'all will see it. Jazz doesn't have to kind of syncopation anymore. That's okay. Music evolves. Like, I'm okay with music. Like, you know, no problem, Neil. Thank you. Thank you so much, man. Yeah, I don't have no problem with music with music evolving. It's supposed to do that. Music is not supposed to stay the same. The issue is not that people aren't playing this beat anymore. The issue is that people don't know about it. And then you can address it. Then you can decide if you want to play it or not. I don't play this just joint like every day. I mean, I listen to it, yeah, but I don't have to play. You know, I don't have to. You know, like Jazzo has kind of syncopation. I mean, it's not even just about the syncopation, like just to address what you said. It's about the beat It's about the beat that's different. I say the syncopation. Jazz still got syncopation all over the place. Problem is that syncopation has become a commodity, like, because people weren't really understanding that joint back in America in the late 1800s. Like, Scott Joplin came up and was like, yo, man, check this out. It's like, oh, my goodness. What? Hello. You know what I mean? So, but, yeah. Let me see. What time is it? Dang, I got to teach a lesson I got to make sure. Okay, I actually got time. I think 12 o'clock is my first tomorrow. Wait, do I even have a 12 o'clock? Hold up. Because if I don't have a 12 o'clock, I can do some Ken Burns right now. Let me go and check out my schedule right now. Oh, yeah, I'm going to be opening up lessons, y'all. Got some more cats going to come in soon. What's my Thursday looking like? Okay, no, I got one at 12. I got one at 12. That's what I got. Okay. All right, I'm going to be opening up lessons. Once I come back from Europe, we're going to start a new round of students. So I'll put out another email. Some people have already contacted me. So, but if not, I'm going to, you know, go ahead and send me an email, and I'll throw you on the waiting list. All right, so I do, okay. Well, I keep this up for, I try to keep it up for 24 hours before YouTube tells me that, like, my channel is going to get deleted or something. So, am I going to Madrid? No, I'm not going to Madrid, unfortunately. I was there 3 years ago, though, with Marquise. Do I do lessons in person? Currently only remotely right now. But yeah, I wanted to go through Ken Burns Jazz. Dang it. But it's like about that time right now. It's about that time, unfortunately. But if anybody got any extra questions for me at the end right now, I'm down to answer them. I think we already went through a lot of what the Ken Burns Jazz would be talking about anyway. So I just wanted to show y'all kind of like the importance of what this was, man. Like what you can learn from this music. You know, this is kind of like an introduction to that. I'll be back this weekend, though. I'll be back this weekend going over more of it. So do not worry. Do not worry at all. We will be coming back to it. I'm glad I at least got to do something for y'all, right? So, but if you got any questions for me, I'm here to answer. Here to answer. I just can't play anymore, that's all. We had a good run, though. Today was nice. Scoot-loodly, scoot-boop-whip-boop-hoodly. With the tune Topsy. How does Topsy go again? What's the earliest recording of it? I just know that, like, that style, the Kansas City style of swing changed a lot of how, like, the people felt the music. That's not what we're talking about. But let's check out the tune anyway and see what you're talking about. Yeah, no. This is straight into Papa Joe. This is straight into swinging. Like, you gotta learn to hear the difference in the rhythm. They weren't playing like that. That's doom, chank-a-ding, chank-a-ding, chank-a-ding. That's Kansas City. They weren't playing like that in New Orleans. That was later. So, no, that's not the same thing. Oh, also, that's 37. The music completely changed by 37. Once the music moved out of the hood and went to the cities. Yeah, Big Four, all of that stuff. Yeah, but it's not just that. It's about the way they felt the beat. It's not just Big Four. They, you know, that was prevalent in swing music too, but, you know, it's not chank-a-ding, 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 chank-a-ding. We're not doing that yet. It's chank-a-ding, 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 chank-a-ding. You know, that's what we're talking about. The beat. You know what I mean? Where the bird? There we go. Yeah, we got to talk about the connection, right? Fletcher Henderson. But Louis Armstrong, yes sir. Y'all talking like, again, like, not no offense, but y'all are talking about elements. Like, y'all talking about very specific little things in the music. I'm talking about the beat. The space in between the note, the space from beat one to the end of one. I'm talking that deep. The space between the difference between and right? And the accents is the difference. It's not straight either. You know, can I highlight any traditional music between those concepts? Yes, Louis Armstrong. Louis Armstrong is when people started like feeling the beat a little differently. That's why I played that heebie jeebies. You know, that's why I started playing that heebie jeebies, because Louis Armstrong was playing looser. He was playing a little more loose. If you listen to like Sugarfoot Stomp, right? Like, there's so many recordings of this. I want the 1925 one, so I want to make sure that's the one we listen to. Right? Right, I'll play a little bit. I still got 2 minutes left. There's a difference between that and this. Remember, this is the last thing I'm going to play. I can't play too much later now. So we're going to do this. Actually, no, it's Jones Smith Incorporated. Old lady, be good. You got to play different. I wish I had my tenor out. My tenor is packed up. So I'm going to try to play like Leslie on alto. But complete difference. You gotta play different. Thank you. That's swing. You swing your body. You know what I'm saying? You hear how different that is? From the azuka the stomp, azuka that stomp. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, but up in here you got. You know what I'm saying, the feeling switches, bro. And the accents. The problem is that people only know this because there's been some kind of a concerted effort for everybody to be against Wynton Marsalis because everybody hates him and everybody hates that he told people to check out history. So now the only thing, the farthest back people go to when listening to this music is just, oh man, yeah, like, I've checked out some Lester, you know, like, and that's it, you know. Coleman Hawkins, been, he's like, yeah, but do you check out Coleman Hawkins in the 20s? You know, it's just like, it's like, well, I got to learn this. Blah, blah, blah. You got a lot of people. I've got some comments on my videos. Like, I don't care. I don't give a hoot. Who the one that's up here? Who gigging? What you doing? You know what I'm saying? I'm here. Fight you to the death on this joint. Like, you know, I will. But not with fists. With my horn. Who hates when? Oh, see, we're in the generation now where young people just love it. But, like, back when I was growing up, as a kid, I was so confused because I love the stuff Wynton was saying, but people older than me, nah, not having it. Not having it. They're just like, nah, man, like, who cares about Louis Armstrong? Anyway, my point is that I'm confident in what I do because I feel like I'm armed with the actual history and the respect for the people who've come before me. You know what I mean? Like, really digging into it. I get it. I can feel it. I can understand why it's so important. So I'm up here trying to, like, you know, preach the reverence. But, like, you can go up and look at recording and be playing some video game music. So, like, there should be no reason why you have any doubt that, like, I'm current, that I'm living in the time, that I'm living in 2022. Why does it have to be such a big deal to check out the history? He says some not great things. Well, yeah, well, so have the people who don't like him. They've said some not great things. Everybody, your uncle said some not great things. Your mama said some not great things. Your best friends, you have said some not great things. Think about all our heroes that we love always said. Duke Ellington said some not great things. Even Louis Armstrong has said some not great things. I rest my case. And it's not even that he said some not great things. He said some, for example, why do people have a different opinion on Branford than Wynton? Let's talk about this. Let's talk about it. I want to open up this can of worms. Anybody here understand why Branford didn't get the success that Wynton got? Branford's not the one that won a Grammy for both jazz and classical in the same year. Branford's not the one that got up and said, you got to check out the history. But yeah, Branford has said some way more opinionated and crazy stuff than Wynton has ever said. Yes, for a fact. Branford has said, and I love both of them. If they're watching, you know how much I love both of y'all. And Branford was like a mentor to me for like 8 months. Like, I love him to death. Both of them. But who was the one that was playing on the pop stuff and the rock stuff and on Tonight Show and with Sting? You know what I'm saying? Who did all that stuff? Branford. But Branford has said some crazy. How come Branford can literally openly insult his students? He can't, for everybody who's watching, you know, like, pardon my, I'm just quoting him. This is not my words. He said, I think students today are full of shit. Yeah, we can hear him say that. We can hear Branford say that and be like, oh, yeah, right on. Yeah, man, I love Branford. But then Winton says we got to check out the history or, like, have his opinions about hip-hop, whatever. And all of a sudden, he's the antichrist of modern jazz. Huh? Why is that? Because Winton got successful. Winton's making the money. Jazz musicians love people who don't make money. We want everybody to be poor, just like us. If you broke, you're one of us. We hate when people get a platform and start using it for the way they want to use it. God forbid you actually play jazz, use a platform, influence people, and use it the way you want to use it. No, you better use the platform the way I want you to use it. Oh my goodness. A platform that somebody is using. For a platform that someone's using in the way that they want to use it. Oh my goodness. That sucks. It really sucks that I don't have my platform to tell my student, you know, like, come on, bro. People don't understand, bro. Yeah, same thing about the Kenny G haters. How can Branford say all this stuff way more disrespectful than Winton's ever said? It's better to hate on Winton than it is on Branford. It's dumb. This is what I'm talking about. People just love to talk. It's because Winton has said some stuff that's attacked a very specific part of them, you know? Yeah, sure. You said bigger platform, bigger. What does that mean, VK? What does bigger platform, bigger target mean? Winton went his way and Branford went his way. That's the only difference. Winton decided to do his thing the way he wanted to do it, and Branford did his thing the way he wanted to do it. And they were both in Blakey's band. They both were doing the same thing. They were both playing, but then they went different directions. That's all that happened. And now we mad at the person that went in the more successful direction. Stupid. It's stupid. Also, what's up, Kevin? Good to see you, bro. Very good to see you. Yes, exactly. We should uplift each other even if we don't necessarily do music. Yes, absolutely. 100%. 100%, bro. That's what I'm talking about. I just think it's amazing how, like, there's so many double standards about this stuff. People will come up to me. I can name one person in particular that openly hates me. I can actually name him by name, but I won't because I don't steep that low. Y'all can do your own research if you want. There's people here in the chat that probably have played, like, you know, we know. But, you know, I got people that hate me too, and I love it. You know, that means that I'm doing something right. That means that I've been successful in having the confidence to preach what I believe in. You know, that's all I can ask for. Bring it on. I'll play my horn. I'll play my horn, bro. That's all I'm doing, bro. The reason I got up here and started talking about stuff is because I hear music a certain way, and I want to share that with people. So if people don't like that, go be it. So be it, you know. You're going to have to deal with me on the scene at some point. That's all I got to say. So, but anyway, if any more questions. Jazz is such a fun genre, but it sucks people really take it that seriously. It's a fun, groovy genre, but the way people get upset over such small things just makes you sad. Let people have beliefs. Well, again, that's because, like, you know, this music is, you know, it has a very complicated history. That's why I love Ken Burns' jazz series. Because, like, you get to see at least the most important parts of it. It's not the entire story of jazz, but it's, like, those parts that, like, transformed it to make it what it is that created the opinions that people have, you know? So you get to get a snapshot into it. You get to see why certain things happened. It's like, huh. This is why people are talking about it. You know, it's very deep. It's very deep. Once you see, like, oh, man, like, man, we're talking about preaching the music as a continuum, but cats back in the day actually didn't see it that way. And then, like, you start talking about how jazz split. Like, we got to talk about the split in jazz between, you know what I mean? Like, the split in jazz in the 1940s. It's neither the history is being written as we speak. All history is being written as we speak, yes. But we don't recognize it until 25 years later. So, after the thing happens, that's when we start to look at it. Thank you, Andrew, for the $5. I really appreciate that. And also, thank you so much for tuning in. It's really great to see you. It was, like, a really beautiful surprise for me. It's honestly so, like, yeah, I can't tell you how grateful I am. So please, let's connect in any kind of way. I don't know. I think if you join the Discord, great, then I'll see you there. Otherwise, you can message me. But yeah, great to have you here. Have a great night. Thank you so much again, and I'll hope to see you soon. So, how much do I tell a student to play along the continuum of music? Everybody needs to play along with recordings. I was talking with Etienne Charles about this, actually. Etienne Charles was like, he was saying, like, yeah, people don't play along with recordings as much. You know, yeah, that's why I love the Aebersolds. Like, somebody asked me, like, why do I, it's my Discord. It's this. Yes, I changed my name to 2516. I changed my number. But yeah, like, how much? All the time. I don't know how to say how much. Like, just play. Yeah, play. Like, if you're trying to get close to something, play with it. Like rock musicians play along to Led Zeppelin records and Jimi Hendrix. You know, funk musicians play along to, you know, P-Funk and Isaac Hayes. Why are jazz musicians not doing that? You know what I'm saying? Like, we got to do it. It's just that problem is a lot of jazz is being taught in schools instead of on the street. And so because it's hard to say, but, you know, because we're not connected to it, and because there's a lot of people getting into jazz that don't have the experience culturally of some other music, like I feel like nowadays the best way to get into jazz is by already having music that you like. Maybe jazz is the music that you like. Great. Like, maybe jazz is the music that you like. Cool. But if you get into jazz from the perspective of just like a mathematical study or something, like, you don't actually like it, you can't play it. You got to play with the records. You got to play the records the same way that you sing along, like your mom sings along in the car to the radio to a favorite song. Or your sister blasts, you know, I mean, I'm dating myself at this point, like, you know, blast Britney Spears or Christina Aguilera or whatever in a room with, you know, you know, same thing. Like, you gotta experience the music in the way that everybody has experienced the music. You know, that's extremely, all right, so VK, thank you for saying that. I really appreciate it. But to me, it's the only perspective. Everybody who like, is successful at this music, like, approaches, like they love the music. They have a love for it. You got to develop a love for it. It doesn't mean you have a love for the study. Like, yes, you have to enjoy the study of it, but the study becomes easier once you just enjoy it, once you just like it, you know? You didn't listen to music until Coleman. That's wow. I'm not a jazz purist, a regular listener to older monocast. So, yeah, well, you didn't listen. So you didn't listen to, like, any kind of hip-hop in the, like, I grew up with, like, hip-hop on the street. You know, I listened to gospel music, church music from my grandma, and then my mom had R&B oldies, hits and oldies on Hot 105 radio. My dad, reggae. Like, I had a bunch of music around me, and then jazz was just, like, a new cool thing that can help me interpret everything that I heard. You know what I mean? Like, I don't think jazz would have been easy for me if I didn't have other types of music that I liked before jazz, you know? So, yo, Dev, always great to see you, Dev. I'm sorry I didn't say hi to you before. I talked to you, but I didn't say hi to you. But, you know, yeah. There are other perspectives, just not the one people generally have. Yeah, of course there are other perspectives. Yes. But when I say the only, I mean, it's organic. It's organic. You know what I mean? Yo, yes, that's how you do it. Keep it modern, Andrew. Smash that like button. Appreciate you. Yes, go ahead. Smash that like button. I love it. Grew up listening to hip-hop, R&B, oldies. Yeah, man, really start. Yeah, there you go. No, music wasn't personal for me. I got you. I mean, if you still got into it, awesome. Awesome. Do I transcribe and then play without anything or with a metronome? Hey, Andrew, that's true, though. I did look up to you, though. I did look up to you for many years. So, yes, that is true. But I have a lot of idols and heroes. So, a lot of idols, a lot of heroes. Do I transcribe and play with without anything? I never use a metronome, basically. I basically don't use a metronome for anything, unless I'm practicing something like drums, you know, like. I got my sticks here for a reason, you know. You know, I practice a lot of drum stuff, just like on my leg or like on a, you know. Like, I just practice a lot of different things. Like with a metronome. That's the only time I think I use a metronome is like with drum stuff. You just have fun. I know you're having fun. Yes, you get a lot of but it's still true at least. Unfortunately, I'm going to have to start wrapping up though, everybody. Thank you, Andrew. Thank you for that. Metronomes are not worth it. Thank you so much. I want to do a video on that. If you want good time, play with the records. What do I have to say to the musician that can't apply the stuff? Yo, thank you for the $5, VK. I appreciate you very much. Thank you. What do I have to say to the musician that can't apply the stuff he practices during gigs and jams? Spend more time practicing playing. Like play. Like, don't practice practicing. Like, well, yes, you should practice practicing for practice sake. Like, practice practicing for practice sake, right? And then you got to practice playing as well. You got to practice getting used to the fear. You got to practice getting used to, like, the discomfort. You know what I mean? How do I play what I transcribe slowly? Recording slow. I don't play stuff slowed down. I get with it. Like, if I can't play it, I struggle until I can play it at the tempo. Like, I just, you know what I'm saying? Like, I wish I could pull out the transcription that's been kicking my butt for, like, 2 months, which is the Cannonball Adderley. Cannonball Adderley, easy to love. I wish I could play that, but I can't play. It's just too, you know, it's too late to play. But, yeah, you know what I mean? Like, you gotta play. And for me, when I play, when I play with the transcriptions, I hear the notes. Like, you can slow down the recording to hear the notes. But after that, play. You got to practice playing at the tempo. You got to mess up until you hit it. You know, like, get the fingering down. If you're not used to the fingering, here's the thing. If you're practicing and you can't hit the fingerings for a specific note, you probably just haven't practiced enough scales. Like, all the stuff that those bebop musicians were doing, you know, or just, you know, like, all the stuff that bebop musicians doing is just scales, bro. You know what I mean? Like, you know, just scales. Like, I can run through so many different scales and show that to you. Like, oh, all this stuff is just scales. If you practice all your scales, patterns, all that kind of stuff independently from the music, you'll get it. Trust me. It'll make sense. And then you can, because then you'll be able to actually play. Scales, arpeggios, like, line runs, all that kind of stuff. All that kind of stuff, bro. That's how you do it. So, how do you practice playing? By playing. Like get out of the practice, like, play what you know. Like, practice playing what you already know at the moment, and then just play, just let it out. You know, whatever you can do, just do it. Just do it. Even if you don't sound good, man, just play. Like have that like that childlike freedom. And transcribing this Desogordon solo, and I got it down, but it took me long to get up to speed. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Like, unfortunately, I got to go, but as I know, I don't see anything with slowing down. Again, Arson, you heard what I just said. If you got to slow it down, it's not a side note. I just told you, if you got to get the notes, slow it down to get the notes. No, nothing wrong with that. I said that. But you better play with the recording to get the beat. You got to play it at tempo so you can understand the phrasing. You don't get the phrasing from it slowed down because it sounds like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it doesn't sound the same. So you got to make sure that you're actually playing with the phrasing. So once you get the notes, then practice it until you, you know, gradually get it. But practice with the beat in your head. But anyway, it's getting late, y'all, unfortunately. So I'm going to start getting out of here. Why not starting slow? Just I didn't do that. It's just because I didn't even have the technology to do that. You know what I'm saying? Like, I didn't have, like YouTube was just coming out when I was, like, when I started playing jazz, YouTube didn't even exist yet. Ornette always said playing music fast is a great, yeah, I agree with that. But anyway, I gotta go, y'all. But thank y'all so much for tuning in. You can catch me on the Discord. You can catch me everywhere. We're going to have a good time doing this. I'm going to try to get back to you maybe tomorrow. On Friday, for sure, you can catch me on the J-Music. Catch me on the J-Music stream. I'm going to be doing live requests to J-Pop, video game, anime music. So, but yeah, thank you so much again, Andrew. I appreciate you. Thank you, everybody. Yeah, Slow Down YouTube didn't exist in 2014. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, just listen. You know how you can practice? You know how you can practice at the tempo? By practice singing it. Kenta-san, but it's great to see you. Great to see you, Kenta-san. Arigatou gozaimasu. Mata aemashou. What if I can't sing? Well, you better practice, then. You better practice getting comfortable sounding bad. Ain't nobody gonna shoot you for sounding bad, and if they do, then you know that's the problem. But anyway, take care, everybody. Much love. Thank y'all so much for being here, and I'm gonna catch y'all on the flip side. You know how we do it. But everybody, peace, y'all.